So I want to be clear, now there's a lot of pressure. I don't promise a historic moment of mathematics, but I hope that I can tell you some interesting things. As Bryna said, probably for this first day at least, the experts will be a little bit bored. At least I hope that you will. And then later in the second and third talks, hopefully everyone will see something a little bit new. A few things to start. First of all, thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me to give the course. Second of all, I want to beg you for questions and interruptions. In fact, they're not interruptions, they're very helpful. So if there's anything that is even remotely unclear, just stop me. We have a very malleable schedule for the talk. Also, if I talk too fast, just raise your hand, say, shut up, you're talking too fast, and I will slow down. I think this is it, yeah. So as far as the topics of the course, it'll be easier once I get started, but maybe the best way is to sort of give a bit of a counterpoint to what Bryna was talking about. So in her course, she's talking about things that have low complexity, or at least zero entropy largely, at least that's what we've seen so far. So what I'm going to be talking about are ZD symbolic systems. I almost forgot the next administrative point. If I write it that font size, can everybody in the back still read it? Speak now or forever hold your peace. All right, so this is the font size I will attempt to stick to for the rest of the time. So we'll speak about ZD symbolic systems, but unlike, they're gonna be different from the ones Bryna discussed for a couple of reasons. So first of all, they're going to be defined via so-called local rules. Of course, I don't need to be coy about this because you've already seen the definitions in a couple of talks. These are going to be so-called shifts of finite type. And I think I'll follow Jerome wherever possible. I will abbreviate things. So I don't want to write shift of finite type ever again. So this will be SFT from now on. I will define all of these things in a moment. And also, they're going to be high complexity. In general, so in general, these are going to be positive topological entropy. Again, I'll remind you of the definitions. This is just sort of an overview. And maybe the third difference is that I'm going to start off giving you some topological definitions, but what I really want to tell you about eventually, as you see if you read the abstract, is mostly we're going to study some properties of measures. So I want to say we'll study measure-theoretic properties. I don't want to say instead of topological properties, I'll still tell you some things about topological properties today, but maybe I'll say more than topological properties. Okay, so now we reach the point where it's silly to keep doing an informal introduction because we want some definitions, but these will sort of be some slight ways in which what I'm going to talk about will be a little bit in a different direction than what Bryna was speaking about. All right. So just to be safe, we'll give some definitions.
Funny.
Yes?
As an American, I can ask you to speak slower.
Everyone can ask me to speak slower, but if an American tells me to speak more slowly, this really carries some weight. The only deal we will make is I will attempt to, but I will get excited about something mathematical, so you just tell me again, and I can go as slowly as this for short periods of time. Okay, so definitions, and again, some of these are reviews from other talks, but I would rather be safe. So we say A, we'll say the alphabet is a finite set A. We'll say that a pattern on A is, okay, I give you the definition I hate, but it's formally correct. It's a function from some set to A, where S is a finite subset of ZD. Okay, if you're good at thinking abstractly, then that's wonderful, but for me, this is not what I picture when I think of a pattern. What I picture is something that looks like this. That's a pattern, right? A pattern is just an arrangement of letters at various locations within ZD, and I consider it to be finite. The main thing I'd like to clarify is that for me, patterns really can have arbitrary shape, so they don't even need to be rectangular.
Is it up to
translation or?
Yeah, so this was the next point I want to mention. I tried to plan for this talk so that these questions would not come up. But no, the question is good, but it will not matter. But to be safe, let's say I consider this pattern the same as this pattern. Okay, so let's say, as you say, they're defined up to translation. If they are congruent, I will say this is the same pattern in some sense. Thank you. What was I saying? Oh yeah, so I don't need them to have a rectangular shape. I don't even need them to have a connected shape. I mean, for me, this would also be a legal definition of a pattern. That being said, most of the time they will be connected, and a lot of the time they will be rectangular, but really arbitrary is fine. Okay, and now what is a shift of finite type? So let's say given a finite set F, F stands for forbidden, of patterns, we say X of F is just the set of all omega, and maybe I say X in A to the ZD, such that X contains no translate of a pattern in F. Okay, and we'll have some examples momentarily, so don't worry if any aspect of this is at all unclear. And we say anything like this is a shift of finite type. If you want me to be really formal, a shift of finite type is a symbolic system where you can find a finite set of patterns such that this equality here holds. Okay? If you don't like this definition, that's okay, because I'm not going to use this very general definition. In fact, I want to work mostly with a subclass of these shifts of finite type. So A nearest neighbor This will be abbreviated as NN usually. Shift of finite type is one where F consists only of patterns of adjacent pairs of letters. So in other words, instead of having crazy patterns with disconnected shapes and all of this, all you will do is you will say, I have some adjacencies in each cardinal direction that I say, these pairs of letters are the ones that I do not want to see. Okay? I keep promising examples. I'll do some examples of this right this second. Before doing examples though, so I guess I lied, I should be clear, this is not really a subclass in the sense that every SFT is topologically conjugate to a nearest neighbor SFT. With apologies, I'm not going to show you this proof right now just because I'm sort of not focusing too much on the topological direction, but for those of you who've studied any symbolic dynamics, you recode with a higher block code and this ends up working out fine. If anyone wants to see the details, talk to me afterwards, I will show you quickly. Mainly, this is a justification that all of the examples I wish to talk about are going to be for this nearest neighbor class, because it will be easier to define and easier for us all to understand. And if you believe this that I wrote, I'm not really restricting what we work with. Okay? So, some examples. Example one. I believe I'm the fourth person to define this example, but just to write it to be safe, let's take a forbidden list to be the empty set. And I want to be careful here. Technically, I should not specify just the forbidden list. I should also tell you the alphabet and the dimension that we work with. So here I could say maybe the alphabet is 0, 1. Maybe just for fun, I say the dimension is 2. And so what would this object be? Well, if we go back here, it's the set of all elements of 0, 1 to the Z2, such that you contain no forbidden pattern. There are no forbidden patterns, so this is just all two-dimensional bi-infinite arrays of 0 and 1. As exciting as the full shift is, I think I won't say anything more about it for now. So this is sort of your starting object. Let's define something a little bit more interesting. Let me define the so-called hard square shift. Here, the alphabet again is 0, 1. OK, technically, I sort of want to define this for every D, but I think if I give you a definition, we will see what it is. So maybe for now, I write D equals 2. And then the forbidden list would be 1, 1, comma 1, 1. So what does this mean? This means you would take all two-dimensional bi-infinite arrays. And the only rule is that I don't want to see two ones that are horizontally adjacent or two ones that are vertically adjacent. I don't believe you need my help here, but just to be safe, here's an example of a point that looks perfectly OK. And this point looks OK until I make a stupid decision. And then this is not allowed. OK? We'll go faster soon, I promise. But this is totally clear to everybody? All right. Is it OK if I don't define the one-dimensional hard square shift? Can everybody just believe that in one dimension, I don't have this one, so it's just this? Some of you probably know that as the golden mean shift. I'll mention in a minute why I'm not using the name golden mean shift. And I need a third example. Yeah, even though it's not good board work, we're not going to use the full shift very much, so let me erase that. So I can, yes?
Why you can call it half square?
Yeah, so the easiest answer, which is mostly accurate, is physicists use this as a model for modeling sort of particles and what you can think of. Suppose I give you a particle where the radius is greater than 1/2, but less than 1 over root 2. OK? That was probably wrong, but I draw a picture anyway. What I want is I want it to be possible for them to sit next to each other diagonally. Pretend that was a circle. But the radius is too big for them to sit next to each other vertically. So really, what this would model, if you had particles that somehow oriented in Z2, I'm not a physicist, and their radius was a certain way, then this would tell you where the particles could sit. Sometimes this is the lattice gas model, but I think the hard is supposed to represent that really they can't sit next to each other, not just that there's some energy where they don't want to. Does this make sense? Cool. Let me get rid of the, this is wet eraser. I want this one. All right, so let's get rid of the full shift because I don't use it so much. The other main example we'll work with are the so-called K colorings. So what are the K colorings? Our alphabet is 1 through K. And the rule is very simple. Maybe again here I'll, just try to say d-arbitrary because I want to be really safe. And the rule is very simple. F is just all adjacent pairs with two copies of the same letter. Okay, so all I mean by this is you can't have two ones next to each other, you can't have two twos next to each other, dot, 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 you can't have two k's next to each other. So just as a silly example, I don't know, let's say if k is 3, then this would be an example in two dimensions of a point that is fine, because I never put the same letter next to itself. And if I do something like, we just ruined it right away, this would not be OK because you can't have the same letter next to itself. Okay? Sorry if it sounds silly, because I know these aren't too hard, but these two examples are the ones I work with most of the time. So any questions about any of them? Nothing yet? OK. So let's define some properties we want to study. Topological entropy. So this was defined already, but I define it again because there's a tiny subtle point I need to be careful about. So this looks like an easy definition. Oops. This is the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 divided by n to the d times the log of the number of legal patterns. Oops, patterns. On an n cube. OK, so why did I put this in quotes? The experts in the audience know why this is a bit of a cheating, loaded statement. What does it mean for a pattern to be legal? Right? So there's two different things we could think of. One is that it just has not violated any of the rules yet. But That's kind of a funny thing to define, because for instance, think of this checkerboard. This pattern looks completely fine so far. Say we're in the three colorings. This pattern hasn't violated any rules. Does everybody see we're in some trouble, though? There's nothing I can legally put here, okay? So there is a very interesting and wide world of this issue of locally admissible patterns, which are the ones that haven't violated rules yet, and globally admissible patterns. If I had four talks, I would spend a talk talking about this. Since I have three talks, I will spend zero talks talking about this, and instead say, even though this is a fascinating question, for the examples we'll consider, any pattern on a rectangle which does not yet contain a forbidden adjacency can in fact be extended to an entire point of the SFT. Okay? So if you work in the world where what we really want to be careful about is this issue of, oh no, sometimes patterns are legal, they look legal, but they are not, I'm sorry that I make the assumption that we don't have to worry about this. But the issue is, even with this assumption, there are a bunch of fascinating things that we can say. Just so we know the terminology, if you don't contain a forbidden configuration, usually this is called locally admissible. And being extended to a point of ZD, or the SFT, is, whoops, globally admissible. And what I'm saying is they're basically going to be the same for rectangular words, and so from the point of view of entropy, you don't have to worry about this distinction at all. Just to be safe, I'll say normally when you actually define the entropy the way you would find it in a textbook, what you get here would be globally admissible patterns, okay? This was kind of subtle, so any questions about this part yet? Okay, the good news is the subtlety won't matter. That's basically what I'm saying. All right. You can't do this simultaneously, okay. All right. So, okay, while the board is moving, here is where I say all of the things I should be talking more about. Topological entropy is a fascinating invariant of dynamical systems. When you take two systems that are topologically conjugate, they have the same topological entropy. There are many information theoretic applications for it. For me, though, I just want to think of it as a number that I would like to know because it's good for a lot of things, and there are some difficulties with knowing it. Okay? So, let's say, example. Okay, this is nearly trivial, but just because I don't think anyone has done it, if I take the full shift, well, then how do I find, maybe Bryna did this actually, but I will be careful. So how do I find the entropy of the full shift? There's a limit. Okay, how many legal patterns are there where the shape is an n cube? Well, how many locations are in the n cube? N to the d power. How many choices do I have at each one of those locations? The whole alphabet. So everybody think of what I should write here. Hopefully you were thinking of this, right? So you... Oh, what did I do? Oh yeah, I was so... Yeah. Thank you. Otherwise this wouldn't work. The n to the d comes down, you take a log, the limit isn't a limit at all, and you get log of the cardinality of A. Fine, we've all seen this before. Here is a calculation I won't do. If you have the one-dimensional hard square, this is just where you have zeros and ones, and the only rule is that you do not put two ones in a row. As I think Benjamin mentioned in his talk, h of x turns out to be the log of the golden mean. This is why many of you may have known this as under the name the golden mean shift. Fine. What about the 2D hard square model? Okay. So here's where I want to pause for effect for the people in the room who don't already know about this. So What I've defined here is, I would say, the simplest two-dimensional shift of finite type. What do I mean by this? If I really want it to be two-dimensional, I need to restrict something horizontally and something vertically. Otherwise, it wasn't really a two-dimensional object. I made one restriction horizontally, one restriction vertically, with the smallest possible alphabet. Okay? No one knows what this number is. Okay? I don't think it has a closed form. This is usually the point where I say, out of all of the ZD shifts of finite type that people study in the world, fine, some of them have entropy like log of a natural number for some very basic reasons. But in terms of non-trivial entropies, I think four are known. So there's four systems where we know closed forms. The complement of four, we have basically no idea what's going on at all. So here, there's no, okay, to be safe, I say no known closed form. Really, I don't think there is one. So Benjamin already sort of covered these things, but what I'm trying to communicate is it's not just some sort of, you know, big picture theorem. Yeah, there are these SFTs out there where we don't know the entropy. This is the most studied ZD SFT that I know about. People have been trying to find the entropy for at least 40 years. Still not known, probably not going to be known. Okay, so it's hard. The good news, though, is maybe we should not be asking for a closed form. Because at the very least, so I say, however, you can compute h of x. And that's a loaded term, so let me try to be clear. I mean compute in the sense that Benjamin talked about. So what this means is there exists an algorithm to find arbitrarily many digits. Let's not say arbitrarily many digits. Let's say to approximate h of x to any desired tolerance. Okay, so this is the universe I want us to enter. This is the universe with these terrible objects that I, for some reason, want to work with for a living. You probably never have closed forms, so we need to sort of reset our brain. If at least I have the ability to say that I know the first 10 digits of the number, that's still pretty good. Okay, and so in fact, this does have this property that it is computable. Fine. Yeah. So, and I should mention one theorem that, again, Benjamin already said, but I really want it to be clear. So Hochman and Majerovic proved that every upper semi-computable number is the entropy of some ZD SFT. I apologize, but I'm not going to repeat the definition of upper semi-computable because I don't need the subtlety. Let me just make sure I point out that this includes non-computable numbers. In other words, I hate to waste a minute, but this is so strange if you haven't heard about it already. I can give you a system defined in finite time. I stand here and I say alphabet, blah, 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 forbidden words, blah, blah, blah. You go try to find the entropy, you cannot find an algorithm that will compute it to an arbitrary tolerance. You should be upset by this. If you're not upset, you're an easygoing person. And in addition to the non-computable numbers, let me point out, it also includes computable numbers where approximation takes arbitrarily long time. In other words, it's possible that your entropy is a computable number, and you say, yay, I can find the nth digit. And then I say, bad news, it will take you 2 to the 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 nth steps to find the nth digit. And then you're not as excited, okay? So what we want to talk about a little bit is how can you sort of get entropy that's computable, and how can you get a good algorithm for it? And for that, could you repeat the question? Okay, so I can tell you a couple of things. First of all, there are 41 conjectured digits for the number, meaning there exists some algorithm that somebody ran. It's a physicist named Baxter. And he ran an algorithm and got conjectured 41 digits for this number. Probably they are correct, but with no proof of correct.
You have to take on your
head. Yeah, so, but I should say, sorry, I'm doing two things at once. Which board do I need to move? Nope. Ha, okay. The rest of the answer to your question, there are 13, I believe, known digits with proof. So I mean where someone has an algorithm that literally gives upper and lower bounds, and you say, ah, see, I'm talking and doing things. All right. When I was sitting and people were having trouble with the board, I said, yeah, what's so hard about the board? So, okay. All right, I need a clean board at the bottom. We're almost there. Okay, this is blank space. Okay, thank you for the help. Yeah, so there are 13 digits that are provably known of this number. And the only other thing I can tell you is that it's known that the computation time is no worse than polynomial. So there exists a polynomial. There we go. That should not have been so difficult, sorry. Okay, so let me actually expand on the answer that I gave him to this question. So,
no.
Don't touch it all, yeah. Okay, touched it very little. Let's go back to the 2D hard square. So if I made this big deal out of telling you, yeah, no one knows a closed form for the number, we're so depressed, at least I'd like to tell you a little bit about how long it takes to compute. So how long to compute to within epsilon. Okay, so let me start with topological properties that give you something about computability, which I think Benjamin already touched on under some different names. And then we will move to measures, because those are sort of the key to this. So here is an important property. And it's what I will call strong irreducibility. And in keeping with the theme of abbreviating things, I will call it SI. If you're worried about the acronyms, I think I only have one more acronym you have to memorize, and you've seen it in another talk, so we should be okay. So what does strong irreducibility mean? This means that there exists some distance, I'll call it R, such that if two patterns, V and W, are legal patterns, we already talked about this earlier. For the examples I want to tell you about, legal doesn't matter so much what we mean. But to be safe, I'll say these are the globally admissible ones, the ones that really show up in entire points of the SFT. Anytime V and W are legal patterns separated by a distance R, we want to say anytime this happens, you can fill in between them to get an entire point of the SFT. To make a point of the SFT. This definition's kind of weird, even though you may have become an expert during Benjamin's talk. So let me show some examples to try to convince you of what this definition is. So I said that the hard square does have this property. Maybe you can imagine what the right distance is, right? So if I give you two shapes, all I need is for them not to touch each other. I just need them to have distance one. So in the hard square, I give you any two shapes in the world. So here's V, here's W. This is one of the points where I can make sure I'm not losing everyone. If I tell you both of these are legal in the hard square so far, what can I definitely put between them to make sure that the entire point is legal? Everyone's put zeros. You can say loudly, yeah, zeros, okay? So if you put zeros everywhere else, well, the only illegal pattern was 1-1. I didn't make any new 1-1, so certainly this is still legal. Everyone agrees? We'll work on the volume for the answers. All right, so we end up getting this strong irreducibility property here with R equals 1. Let's talk about an example of a shift that is not strongly irreducible so that we can sort of get a sense of it. Let's look at the only other example I have on the board, the K colorings. I think we can fit here. Let's look at the three colorings for D equals 2. I claim this cannot be strong irreducible, and here is my reason. Suppose I give you this shape, some kind of an L. Okay? And if you've never seen this before, you're the best candidate to figure out what's going on. So even if you've never thought about this shift, do we see some forced letters? I guess it's a trick question. I see one forced letter at first. That has to be a 2. But now that that 2 is there, this can't be a 2 or a 1, so this has to be a 3. This can't be a 3 or a 2, so this has to be a 1. This 1, 2, 3, 2, 1, 3, 2, 1, blah, blah, blah. And I claim that this is a proof that this is not strongly irreducible. Why? Well, because could you have put any pattern in the world that you wanted here? Well, I don't think so, because what had to go there? A 2. So for instance, if I say I want to have a 3 here, and I erase all of this, please don't make me do it again, but do you think it's possible to fill in this entire shape? Probably not. And this distance could have been as great as possible. So looking around, I really want to make sure this was okay. What I say is, pick your favorite distance. I can construct something like this, which is a little bit bigger, where I will have 2 patterns at that distance, where it is not possible to fill in. So what this means is this is not strong irreducible. You promised to tell me if it wasn't okay. This was okay? Yeah.
If you take the 4 coloring in dimension 2, is it irreducible or is it specific for?
The answer to the question is that I was very careful to choose 3 because it's easy to prove. No, it's fine. For 4 in 2 dimensions, it is still strongly irreducible. The distance you need, I think, is 2 instead of 1. And let me not say anything that I will think is wrong. For 5 colorings, it's really easy to prove a strong irreducibility because you say, no matter what else I've put down, I always have at least 1 choice for what to put here. So 4 colorings is the funny case, and let me invoke speaker privilege and say no more about it for the moment. All right, why am I talking about this strong irreducibility property? I think I can finally get rid of some of these definitions. Let me say some quick facts without proof so that I can get on to some other things. So if a 2-dimensional SFT is strongly irreducible, then this implies that its entropy is computable. But as far as I know, if there's an expert in the room, they can correct me. I believe the best rate that you get of the computability is less than or equal to exponentially many steps to get within 1 over n. Okay? So what I'm saying is there's a natural proof. You just put some patterns together and do some counting arguments. SI implies that the worst case you could possibly be in is that you need exponentially many steps, and maybe fewer, okay? In D greater than 2, SI still implies that H of X is computable. But at the moment, I don't say there's no hope, but at the moment, there's no bound on the rate. So if you read the proof of this is actually from the Hochman-Majerovic paper I mentioned, you don't get anything like, it's at most this many steps. In theory, it could really be 2 to the 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 n. So no known bound on the rate, which is somewhat bad, right? I mean, I'm not a computer scientist, but if we talk about trying to algorithmically calculate things, we would like to have some idea how long it would take. Since I don't know what P equals NP means, then that'll be my proof that I didn't mean anything about. No, sorry, the P equals NP equal. No, and I mean, I don't think I wrote this. I just said there's no known bound on the rate. Maybe if I say no bound on the rate, this would be a statement of the sort.
So this upper bound is known, but low bound of such fact is not known yet.
I would say here, neither bound is known. I mean, I would say here, really, if you just tell me you have a strongly irreducible shift of finite type, here is the entire amount of information that I think is known. The entropy will be computable. It could be with... Oh, I'm sorry, I thought you meant the... Okay, this one. No lower bound is known. And of course, but this is... But of course, this is a trivial statement that I just made, because you know the full shift is strongly irreducible. The entropy is log n. The computation time for log n is quite low. So this is a big open area that I think no one knows how to do, is to give any lower bounds on entropy, or on the lower bounds on the computation time. OK, good question. Any other questions for now?
Just to be clear, so here you're speaking about the number. It's not the fact that you can compute it on the rule.
Let's see. So this statement is the statement that it's possible to compute only from the rules. And then this statement is to say that I cannot give you any information on how long it will take to do that computation. So basically, I definitely don't want to say, oh, but you said decidable. Yeah, so it's decidable, but I cannot give you information like this. I can't give you some sort of a nice bound that says that you could do in less than e to the o of n steps. I'm glad we're getting questions, because this will be...
But I think that the question about the lower bound is mute, in the sense that there are simple examples like the
log n. Yeah.
And it's only interesting to prove upper bounds.
If I say it's only interesting to prove upper bounds, I'll get three more questions about. So, yeah, I think all I can say is to repeat what you said and what I said. There's not much hope for a general lower bound, because log n is one of these, and that number is a pretty trivial number to compute. So, all right. And if I say log base 2, this is even easier, because then there would be integers for the entropy, and then the computation time is zero, or finite, basically. Okay, let me move away from this so I can say something about measures during the first talk here. So, what can I erase? All right, let's move these again. All right. So before I move into measures, let me try to give some motivation. Here is a fact that may be somewhat interesting. If you take h of the hard square in d equals 2, I told you a minute ago that if you use this topological property, the bound you get is that you'd need less than exponentially many steps to compute to within 1 over n. That's not the best that's known. This actually is what's known as polynomially computable. Or I could have said computable in polynomial time. What I mean by this is you can approximate to within 1 over n in polynomially many steps. That's good. That's better than exponentially many steps. So it would be nice to know why this is true. And here's where I sort of want to transition. I don't know of any method of proof using topological properties, such as this, that will give you polynomial time for approximation. The proofs that will yield things like this need measures. So at first, this seems a little bit surprising. I defined a notion purely topologically. If you really want to be careful, purely combinatorially, in fact. And yet, I'm telling you that we use measures. So how are measures used for the proof? We'll see that in the last 15 or 20 minutes here. So.
Can you say something on the exponent?
I can, but then you will want me to leave. OK, so no, due to a failure, not because it's complicated. The best upper bound I know on this exponent is... No. You thought that was bad enough. That's the best. So unfortunately, That's the best upper bound I know for the exponent here. I would like to say more about the reason for this, but maybe if you ask a question at the end, I can tell you more. To give you a real answer, I believe the exponent is approximately 10. But if you do some computer simulations, but this is the best I can say for now. All right, pretend I didn't tell you this. So how do measures play a role in any of these things at all? So first of all, I should say what measures we work with. So all measures are Borel, probability, and shift invariant. I apologize for not explicitly defining the shift map, but I think I would be the fifth person. Everybody agrees the shift map is the one where you pick up a point and you put it back down? Okay, so I don't define this part again for now. So all measures that we talk about have these properties. How do measures play a role in entropy? Because there's a notion of measure theory. Before that, what is a measure defined by? It's defined by values on some so-called cylinder sets. I think these were already defined, but this is really important, so let's define again to be safe. What is a cylinder set? So suppose W is some word or some pattern with shape S, meaning that it comes from a mapping from A to S. Then the cylinder set of W is the set of all X in your space, such that X, maybe I use this notation, sees W at the location of its shape. So in other words, it's just all of the points you get by placing your word down and allowing any arbitrary things everywhere else. Just a quick statement that might be too obvious. The reason we define it this way is because if you just say the set of points that see a W somewhere, that's invariant, and if you take an ergodic measure, it's always going to be 0 or 1. So this is why you need this definition here. And this is called the cylinder set for W. Okay, so now I have to make a definition. Let's put it here because I want to keep it. And the definition is measure-theoretic entropy. Okay, which maybe a lot of us have seen, but it's complicated enough I should write. So what is the definition? It's still a limit as n goes to infinity of 1 over n to the d times the log of something. But now it doesn't come from a count. It comes from information about a measure. So what we do is we sum up for all of the patterns on the n cube. And what we sum is the negative measure of the cylinder set times the log of the measure of the cylinder set. Okay? I have a rule that I don't talk about this indefinitely in talks because it's pointless. For the experts, everything I say is silly. And if it's the first time you see it, you need a few minutes just to stare to understand what's going on. So instead of talking, let's compute this for one example, and maybe this will shed some light on what is happening. So let's do an example. Suppose that your mu is what I would say is the simplest possible measure on the full shift. It's Bernoulli, where every letter has the same measure. So let's say mu is IID, or Bernoulli, with the same measure for all letters of the alphabet. OK? Yeah?
Are you sure you need a log in front of this
thing? Oh, I'm not sure. I heard mumbling and was going to ask, yeah, I did something wrong. OK, thank you. The log should just be on the inside. OK, so just in case we were worrying about the log, so the measure we're looking at is you just take all of the letters of A, give them the same measure, and then make it IID over all locations. The reason this is an easy example is because now if I take a W whose shape is an n cube, what's its measure? Well, at each one of the locations, I made a choice of the alphabet. So this contributes a factor of 1 over the cardinality of A. I did this n to the d times. So hopefully we agree about what the measure of this should be. It should be cardinality of A to the negative n to the d. Right? I made n to the d choices. Each one contributed a factor of 1 over cardinality of A, and these were independent. Or if you prefer, this is the number of patterns. All patterns have the same measure. The measure is a probability measure. Therefore, each one is equal to this. Okay? If you believe this, then we can do this computation. So what do we get? H of mu equals the limit as n goes to infinity of 1 over n to the d times. Well, luckily this sum is pretty easy because in this one particular case, every mu has the same, every w has the same mu. So I get the sum of cardinality of a to the minus n to the d times the log of cardinality of a to the minus n to the d. But this sum has all terms equal to the same value. What's wrong? Minus, but also minus. Thanks. So how many terms were in the sum? Cardinality of a to the n to the d. Times minus, bring the minus n to the d down. Minus and a minus cancel, this and this cancel, this and this cancel, this and this cancel. And we recover a fact that most people in the room already knew, but now we all do. So the measure of this was equal to log of cardinality of A. So we wanted to do this for two reasons. One was just so that we could see an example of this computation, but I also want to point out this is equal to the entropy of the full shift. And so what we found in this case is something very nice. We found a measure where the entropy is equal to the entropy of the SFT on which it lives. And this is not an isolated phenomenon. So I think we'll use that board. That's the second one. So while I move this down, I'll just say what I'm about to write. In fact, this is not isolated. Every time I give you a symbolic system, and a shift of finite type in particular, there's a measure which lives on it, where the entropy is actually equal to the entropy, the topological entropy of the SFT. Okay? I'm still going to write this. I just hate wasting the time while the boards are moving. All right. Let's erase this. Okay. So in fact, if mu is supported on x, let's just say if mu is a measure on an SFT x, then first of all, h of mu is less than or equal to h of x. I was going to prove this, but I think it's best if I don't. If you don't know the proof, I will say it's a nice elementary exercise where you talk about when that sum there would be maximized, something with the convexity of the function negative x log x. Fine, more importantly, always there exists a mu such that h of mu is equal to h of x. Before any non-symbolic dynamics people yell at me, this requires the assumption that you're in a symbolic space. If you work with general topological dynamical systems, this is not true, but you should work in symbolic systems because then it is true. Okay? So there always exists a mu with this property, and so we call such a measure of maximal entropy or an MME. Okay? And I think for now, all I will say is MMEs are useful for two reasons. One is, I think Jerome sort of mentioned this, in various senses that I will try to say more about tomorrow, they capture a lot of information about the system. They're really natural measure to look at on the system. But for the problems I'm talking about, there's an even more direct connection. If you compute this, then you've computed this. And it turns out that there are some nice techniques that will allow you to compute the measure-theoretic entropy pretty well. Okay, so here's where I should check. I started a little late. Do I have 5 minutes or 10 minutes? 10? Okay. I will try not to use 10, but that should be easy. So for the very end of the talk, I just want to say, what do we know about measures of maximal entropy? Or what do MMEs, MMEs look like? Well, let's start with d equals 1, and then I'll tell you the bad news in d equals 2. So d equals 1. Good news, and this is on SFTs. Everything I'll tell you about is on SFTs. In fact, it's on nearest neighbor SFTs. Okay? D equals 1, good news, it's a Markov chain. It's just a traditional Markov shift on a finite alphabet, nice, comfortable object. So that's nice. I won't talk too much about d equals 1 because d equals 2 is what we really need to talk about, but you know good things about the mixing rate of this Markov shift. You have explicit formulas for the transition probabilities. Everything is really, really, really nice. And this has a name, it's called the Perry measure. There's one thing I want to be a little careful about though. It's not necessarily unique, okay? So for instance, let me give you a really silly example. What if my one-dimensional shift of finite type looks like this? So I take all the possible sequences of zeros and ones, disjoint union with all of the possible sequences of twos and threes. Everyone's being very nice and not yelling at me that this isn't a shift of finite type the way I defined it, right? Usually I should give you forbidden words, but maybe we can imagine the forbidden words. Forbid any way of changing from a 0, 1 to a 2, 3, and vice versa, and then you only get these. Okay? Fine. Since time is a little low, I skipped some computations, and I'll just say the entropy is still log 2. Probably you can see why this is. How many words are there of length n? Let's do this part carefully. How many words are there of length n in this piece? 2 to the n. This piece has 2 to the n. The factor of 2 you get from combining them contributes nothing, and you still get h of x equals log 2. All right? If we're awake, then you know of at least 2 measures of maximal entropy on this system, right? We already talked about, can you get a measure of maximal entropy on a full shift? Sure. So here, there's a Bernoulli measure that's an MME. And here, there's a Bernoulli measure that's an MME. So that's sort of annoying. So we have 2 ergodic MMEs. Just to be safe, I say at least 2, but there are only 2. And they're the Bernoulli measures on the 2 full shifts. And in some sense, this is bad. It's nice to have a unique measure of maximal entropy. In fact, it's most of what I'm going to talk about for the second 2 lectures. So the good news is, you really need something silly like this in order to have multiple MMEs. So the theorem I'll state is, if your SFT is at least topologically transitive. If you don't know what topologically transitive is, then I have a nice definition for the end of the talk, not this. It's just something where you can actually move back and forth between the letters of the alphabet. Then you have a unique MME. Okay, so that's good news. All right, so we've got a little over 5 minutes left. Let me actually stay with d equals 1 for a second because there's one other property that I should mention that maybe we don't all know. So for the Perry measure, let's see. Yeah, I will write the proof very briefly. So this is a Markov chain, as I said here. The formulas for the probabilities are actually known. So the probability of state I is equal to, okay, someone can help me if I get this wrong. This should be L sub I times R sub I, and the probability of transitioning from state I to state J is R sub I divided by lambda R sub j. I'm going to commit a cardinal sin here, but you'll see why I do it. Let me not tell you what any of these numbers are. So I promise you they're numbers associated in some way to the SFT. Of course, for the people who know, they're eigenvectors and eigenvalues of some sort of a matrix. But for the point I want to tell you, it actually doesn't matter. Just trust me that this is a formula. Now, what happens if I wanted the measure of the word A, B, C, D? Well, of course, this is kind of hard because I didn't tell you what any of this stuff means, but we can all just copy and paste, right? So what should this be? It should be the probability of the first letter times the probability of transitioning between these two letters. Think these are switched. Someone should have caught me. I think it's the RJ on the top. Michael, you're making a face. I'm pretty sure this is the way it goes. So then we would have the transition between these. Then we would have the transition between these. Then we'd have the transition between these. Okay? Even if you don't know what these numbers are, you can see if they cancel. And this. And let me point out something very strange, and it's sort of one of the last points I'll make here. What's left? LA times R sub D times 1 over lambda cubed. Whatever on earth any of those things are. The thing I want you to notice is how many B's and C's show up. And the answer is, there aren't any of them. So in other words, in fact, if you want to know the measure of this word, the only relevant things are the first letter and the last letter. And this is kind of an interesting property of this measure of maximal entropy that I don't think is always really mentioned. So the key here is that, yeah, let's move this. So the key here is that mu of some long word depends only on the first and the last letters. Just to be safe, it depends on one other thing. It depends on the fact that the word I gave you is legal. Even 55 minutes into the talk, I hope we agree, if I give you a word that is not even in the SFT, its measure should probably be zero, right? So, and the fact that A1 through AK is legal in your SFT. Okay, let me phrase, is there a question? Thank you, yes. Absolutely, thanks. We'll phrase this a slightly different way so that we can transition to two dimensions, probably tomorrow. If you want to know the measure of seeing some cylinder set conditioned on, let me say this in words instead, I think it's better. Given A1 and AK, all words with first letter A1, last letter AK, length K, and which are legal, have the same measure. And there's a reason I'm obsessing over this. I already will spoil what's going to happen. In D equals 2, almost everything you want that's good goes away in life. You're left with nothing. And something like this is going to be all that is left. And I think I still have literally 1 minute, so I write one thing and then we'll be done for today. Let's erase. Yeah, let's erase this. So all of this we'll mainly talk about tomorrow, but the final thing I want to say is, what about D equals 2? So let me give you some good news and bad news, nothing with a formal definition yet. Bad news, topological conditions, such as SI, do not imply uniqueness. So that's too bad. Before I could sort of say, as long as I had an object that wasn't sort of trivial in some sense, you had uniqueness. Now I cannot. The only piece of sort of good news, the light at the end of the tunnel, I will say, to keep you coming back tomorrow, is some analog of this property still holds. And in fact, this is basically the only thing we're going to have to work with to start working with ZDSFTs. But in fact, this is enough to really do quite a bit. And so the very last thing I will say, it's not a Markov shift, because what is a Markov shift even supposed to be in two dimensions? The answer is there's some sort of an analog which is a Markov random field. It's okay if we don't know what this is, because that's the first thing that we can learn tomorrow. So I'll go ahead and end with that. Thanks.